Good afternoon, everyone. A nice sunny day for us. We're hoping that means spring will be on its way. I'd like to welcome you to today's Book for Lunch program. My name is Jane Anderson, and I'm the managing librarian here at the Word Library. If you haven't, please take a moment to turn the ringer or your cell phone off. Our cookies and coffee are provided by the Friends of the Bay County Library System, so hopefully you had one or two to enjoy, and if not, grab one on your way out. Hear me? There are 8 organizations that make up A La Carte, Bay City's Arts and Culture Collaborative: Bay Arts Council, Bay City Players, Bay Concert, and Bay County Library, Historical Society, Bay County Library System, the Delta College Planetarium, State Theater, and Studio 23, the Arts Center. These groups provide lively arts and culture for our community. You can find those on What's Next Bay City, or we have the link in our newsletter as well. Upcoming for the Bay City Players is a musical, Crazy for You. It is a new Gershwin musical, and it will be showing April 22nd through the 24th and April 29th through May 1st. Sounds like a lot of fun, and there's going to be some great music. A couple upcoming programs that will be here at the Wirt Library are on Monday, May 16th at 6 o'clock in this room. We're going to have a program about essential oils, what they are, and how to use them. On Thursday, June 23rd at 6 o'clock, Andrew and Wendy Mutch will be doing a program on Michigan kit houses. Now, Bay City was home to the Ladin Company, which was one of America's most long-lived manufacturers of mail-order kit homes. It was begun in 1906 by two brothers, Otto and William Sovereign. So put that on your calendar. You can learn about upcoming events in our newsletter or on our website, what programs are scheduled, what classes, new services, like now you can check out magazines on your digital devices, or that next week is National Library Week. And you can get replacement library cards and a free DVD each day and things like that. So this is what our newsletter looks like, and there's some up here, and they can be sent to you. The author for next week is Len Norman, and he'll be sharing with us his book, Finding 52, and it's a tale focusing on a ragtag group of misfit cops and an inherently evil serial killer. But today our presenter is Tim Younkman, and he will be reviewing Napoleon, A Life by Andrew Roberts. Mr. Younkman is an award-winning journalist. He received his degree in journalism from Michigan State University. He was a crime reporter for the Clinton County Times, Muskegon Chronicle, Bay City Times, and M Live. He reported on government corruption and drug cartels that were operating in Michigan. So, I mean, he could keep us entertained just with those stories. Mr. Younkman is an author of novels for e-readers with historic venues. He also has a webpage with stories of local historic interest and on current events. And he has a book that will be published May 30th, 2016, and the title is Wicked Bay City, Michigan. Please welcome Tim Younkman.
Well, that was pretty good. Can you hear me okay?
Oh, yeah.
All right? Can you hear me?
Good? Yep.
Mm-hmm. Well, today, when we're talking about Napoleon, the book, Napoleon, A Life, is very long, over 900 pages, and it is probably the most definitive book on or biography of Napoleon. And it came to light because Andrew Roberts had done several books and stories about Napoleon, but then he was able to go through something like 35,000 letters and notes that either Napoleon wrote in his lifetime or were written by his associates about him. And so he's able to piece together a lot more information than they had before. And while it didn't change a lot of the perception of Napoleon, it gave a lot of the more juicy details of his life that had only been supposed before, but now they were able to verify it. And I'm going to see if this thing works here. Napoleon may have had more media attention, including more books and movies and even songs, than any other historical figure. Roberts points out that there have been more books with Napoleon in the title than there have been days since his death in 1821. Many of them are based on erroneous information and outright falsehoods. And they provide a false view of one leader who have had the most lasting impact on France.
I got to the next one. Oh,
okay. Is it working?
When you want
to. Oh.
Yep.
Okay, well, yeah, as long as it works, we'll. If you want to, I'll point to
you. Have a try.
So, technology. That's it. Now, the author is a 53-year-old British historian with several earlier works on Napoleon, concentrating on his last battle at Waterloo. And he also has written about World War II, and this is an array of some of his works. Now, this latest biography delves a lot in his personal life, which I don't know how he had time for any battles, because he had literally hundreds of lady friends who entertained him for an evening or two. But then he had extended relationships. They found 22 of them, where he would correspond with these ladies, and a lot of, they were mainly maybe royalty, or some of them had been married to his officers. I selected four of these ladies just as an example. Now this has just happened between other, of course he had a 20-year career, but this happened between 1802 and 1808. The first one on the far left is Giuseppina Grassini. She was an actress who had the distinction of being the mistress to both Napoleon and the Duke of Wellington. And the Wellington was the officer who defeated Napoleon at Waterloo. She was an Italian opera singer and an actress. And he first met her, of course, when he was in charge of the army in Italy. He'd heard about her, and then when he became emperor, he decided to pay her a visit. The second one, Marguerite Georget, known by the stage name of Mademoiselle George. She was the mistress both of Napoleon and Wellington, and Tsar Alexander I of Russia.
Wow.
With whom she had a daughter.
Busy gals.
Yeah, well, they were smart. They knew what to do. So, the next one, Maria Walewska of Poland. She was a Polish nobility and a divorcee. She became involved with Napoleon in 1806 in the hope of influencing him to take control of Poland and free the nation from Russian control. She followed him around Europe and eventually gave birth to his son. She then married a French military officer, who probably was arranged by Napoleon. The fourth there is Eleanor Denwell de la Plaine. She was a young woman, also a divorcee, whose affair with Napoleon began after being introduced by Napoleon's sister in 1808. She bore him a son, which acknowledged the fact that he was able to produce children, and that was an example for Josephine, who could not. The baby was named the Count Leon. After the affair, Napoleon arranged for her to marry another French officer. He was good at that.
He had a whole army.
He had a whole army. He may have needed them from the sound of it. However, these ladies were his most serious relationship. The first one, you may know the name Desiree. Movie was made about their relationship. He had proposed marriage to her, and she was a very young woman and very beautiful. But he ended up later on marrying Josephine de Beauharnais, who had been married to a general who lost his head during the revolution. And Roberts points out numerous mistresses, of course, but then he became involved with Marie Louise of Austria and married Josephine and then married Marie Louise. Now, the thing about Napoleon was that he wasn't French. He was an Italian by way of Corsica, which was by then under French control, but it originally had been Italian it had been overrun numerous times by various cultures, but ended up being Italian under a general. But his hero, for example, was not Greek. Alexander the Great was Macedonian. Catherine the Great was not Russian, but Prussian. Queen Elizabeth's family isn't English, it's German. You can go back, Joseph Stalin wasn't Russian, he was Georgian. And Hitler wasn't German, he was Austrian. And George Washington would say he was a Virginian. But anyway, Napoleon was from Corsica, an island in the Mediterranean off the coast of Italy. And he was born in Ajaccio, one of Corsica's largest communities, on August 16, 1769. He had four brothers and three sisters who survived childhood, he being the second oldest. Roberts concentrates a chapter on many details of the family background and the transformation of Corsica from Italian control to French. His true name throughout his childhood was Italian, really, Napoleone di buona parte, which is Italian for good portion, for whatever that may mean. And his family was a minor Tuscan royalty connected to Genoa. Still, he eventually was educated in France, although his French was halting, and he always spoke with a Corsican accent. Napoleon attended the École Militaire and graduated in 1785, entering a military life in an army still in the service of King Louis XVI. So he was a royalist. From there, as they say, the rest is history. Some of it, as we know, and we've read about it, we've been told about it, but Roberts, through all of these letters and notes that he found, gives an entirely different viewpoint, a starting point, actually, for some of the events in his life. The book has been very well received since its release in late 2014, winning a number of awards. In the Washington Times Review, Aram Bakshian Jr., former aide to Presidents Nixon, Ford, and Reagan, describes the book as a pleasant discovery, a contemporary historian writing about one of history's true giants in a way that is accessible to an intelligent general audience without sacrificing truth to sensationalism. And that may be true enough, but that is another way of saying the author is aloof in his storytelling. And at least I found that to be true. He does present each element much like a news story. Heavy on facts, without interjecting himself into the story. It's a complete picture of Napoleon's life and involvement in historical events along with the figures he encounters. The stories of the numerous battles in which Napoleon was engaged tends to bog down the narrative somewhat by necessity because of the need to insert as many facts as possible. For readers who don't know the geography or terrain, there are maps interspersed at various points, but it is still difficult to get one's bearings in following the flow of battle. Roberts also writes much like William F. Buckley spoke, inserting words that no one knows or ever heard of before and must look them up to learn their meaning. And maybe that was his point. Perhaps Roberts, an Englishman, as we know, actually speaks that way, and his use of such words came naturally. The criticism aside, if one wants to know as much as possible, and not only about Napoleon, but about that whole era from the French Revolution to the end of the Napoleonic Wars, this is the one source that you need. One of the greatest achievements of Napoleon's reign was the so-called Code Napoléon, or officially known as the Code Civil des Français, reforming the numerous legal codes and laws into one. Each section of France had their own codes, and no one knew what they were. If you go from one place to another, they were entirely different laws. He appointed Jean-Jacques Régis de Cambaceres, a lawyer and statesman in charge of the project, who organized a committee to do the work beginning in 1801 and finishing in 1804 when it went into effect. It was a far-reaching and shocking change in the law as it affected the middle-class people especially. According to Roberts, quote, it confirmed the end of ancient class privileges, and with the exception of a primary education, of ecclesiastical control over any aspect of French civil society. Above all, it offered stability after the chaos of the revolution. He continued, it guaranteed the equality of all Frenchmen in the eyes of the law, freedom of person from arbitrary arrest, the sanctity of legal contracts freely entered into, and allowed no recognition of privileges of birth. It established total religious toleration, including for atheists, separating church from state. It allowed all adult men to engage in any occupation and to own property. Now, is it any adult men? There we go. Roberts observed that the code drew criticism over the years because of its dismissive stand towards women's rights or lack of women's rights. It made wives too dependent on their husbands and that its inheritance provisions were damaging for an agrarian economy. Roberts quoted, it was certainly true that the code was deeply sexist by 21st century standards with a strong patriarchal base. Now, the code makes it clear that the husband's duty was to protect his wife, and the wife's duty was to obey the husband. Roberts notes that the grounds for divorce were restricted to adultery, and then only if the husband introduced a permanent mistress into the family household. If he didn't bring her home, okay. The grounds also included conviction of a serious crime and grave insults or cruelty, although it also could be granted by mutual consent. By the way, a wife could be imprisoned for 2 years for adultery, while a man would face a fine. Men were protected from having to support illegitimate children or even to acknowledge their paternity. He points out that women could not take part in legal contracts, taking part in lawsuits, serving as witnesses in court, or witnesses to birth, death, or marriage. They could not give, sell, or mortgage property without the husband's permission. The code ended primogeniture, providing that most of an estate must be distributed evenly among the heirs, rather than to just the firstborn male. One may gasp at such blatant discrimination, yet its principles weren't much different and may have kind of drawn some information from the United States Constitution and its Bill of Rights, which allowed slavery and subservience of women. In tracing all aspects of Napoleon's life, there wouldn't be much information available if it wasn't for these letters that he had written or had been written to him. Now, not very many of those letters to him survived. Most of the ones that he had written were saved by people and were found later on. Now, one myth that Roberts points out is merely that, although one best known among the general public, was a myth of how short Napoleon was. In fact, we refer to someone who tries to make up for shortcomings by bravado as having a Napoleonic complex. Well, he wasn't that short, and in fact, he was of average height for the 18th century Frenchman, which was about 5'7". In the midst of the French Revolution's low point, known as the Reign of Terror, Napoleon had risen in the military ranks to colonel. You remember, he originally was a royalist, but he switched sides because he was smart. He had risen in the military ranks to colonel and was befriended by the bloodthirsty leader Maximilien Robespierre and his brother Augustin. In 1794, Napoleon was appointed commander of the Army of Italy. which engage in a series of battles against the Austrian and Piedmontese forces in northwest Italy. If that's working, if you don't want to stand there, right?
Oh.
It's up to you.
Yeah.
Okay. I can try. I'll call you back. After the conflict had settled, he settled for a time in Nice and began courting a 16-year-old beauty from a wealthy family, Eugenie Desiree Clary. Much has been made over the years of this romance, and there was that movie that was made featuring Marlon Brando and Gene Simmons. Now, as an aside, Marlon Brando, I think, from that era, was the image of Napoleon. And he really did do quite a job in that movie. Robert states that the courtship actually was carried out mostly by correspondence, including the engagement. Their families already were linked in that Napoleon's brother, Joseph, had married her sister, Julie, the year before. We'll see if this works. Hey. And my spelling is off. No, it's just the way that thing, the E fell off. As this was going on, the chaotic revolutionary movements continued to shift in Paris, and suddenly, the Robespierre brothers were considered terrorists, which they were, of course. Yeah, but they were accused of seizing too much power for themselves personally, and they were arrested on August 9th, 1794, along with 60 others, and all were guillotined on the next day. Many knew that Napoleon and all of his contacts and associates were suspect, and at any moment they too could be arrested and sent to the blade. In fact, he was arrested and imprisoned to await trial, but the appointed prosecution committee found little evidence to link Napoleon or his family to any plot against the government or criminal violation. So he was released from prison, and he again pursued his engagement of Eugenie, and that's what he called her rather than Desiree. He wrote her, quote, "The charms of your person and character have won over the heart of your lover." And of course, he had barely seen her, let alone been her lover. But that's Brando. Then he more or less broke the spell by sending her a list of books he wanted her to read to increase the charms of her intellect. He said later he would send her his thoughts on music. He urged her to improve her memory and to form her reason. Roberts wrote that Napoleon's letters to her showed that he was pleased with her letters to him, and that he certainly had fallen in love with her. But as time moved on, he received few letters from her, and finally he realized that, for whatever reason, her interest had waned. Maybe she read a little more than he wanted her. It could be, Robert speculates, that Desiree's mother discouraged the association, since one Bonaparte in the family was enough. His rejection by her embittered him towards women in the short term and had a lasting effect on how he viewed them for the rest of his life. In other words, he would love them, but only when it was convenient. And for a military man engaged in fighting and risking death, it wasn't convenient. Josephine Tasker entered the picture as Roberts traces her beginnings having been born and raised in the French colony of Martinique. At 16, she married her 19-year-old cousin, to whom she was betrothed in Paris in 1779, Alexander de Beauharnais. He was cruel and vicious. He beat her often and hated her for what he called her lack of intelligence. He also berated her for her looks because her teeth were bad. Alexander had risen in the ranks over the following years, becoming a general in 1792 in the French Revolutionary Army. He was one of the troops sent early on with the French units to aid the colonists in the American Revolution. He was suspected of being an aristocrat and a royalist at heart during the Reign of Terror in 1794. He was arrested on orders of Robespierre and guillotined. Now, Josephine was also arrested, and she was jailed in the same prison as her husband, and she was scheduled for execution. But then, suddenly, all of the action turned against the Robespierre brothers, who themselves were guillotined, and some of the prisoners were freed, including Josephine. Roberts described how this terror must have affected her. The stench, the darkness, the cold, the degradation, the daily fear of violent death, for weeks on end, makes the terror well named. And it is likely that for months, possibly even years, afterwards, Josephine suffered from a form of what we would now call post-traumatic stress disorder. If she was later sexually self-indulgent, became involved in sleazy business deals, and loved luxury, they said her dress bills became higher than that of Marie Antoinette, and married for stability and financial security rather than love. It's hard to hold this against her after what she had been through. Despite having the bad teeth, which she hid by learning to smile without displaying them, she otherwise was a very attractive woman and engaged in affairs with a number of high-ranking politicians. She then sent her son, 14-year-old Eugène de Beauharnais, to General Napoleon to retrieve her dead husband's sword, which was merely a ploy to get him to recognize her. Although she wasn't attracted to him personally, she wanted his protection and wealth to pay her debts. She and Napoleon were married in a civil ceremony on March 9th, 1796, a union that would last for a decade. While he expressed his love for her on many occasions in his letters, and she for him, she strayed from the vows more than once. Roberts described a telling incident in which Napoleon, perhaps thinking himself a wit, responded to an admiring woman who asked him who he considered to be the best kind of woman. He said, "She who has had the most children." That's it. The book goes into great detail of his leading the army into Italy and later into Egypt. The main thrust of most military action was accomplished to challenge the perennial enemy, England. For nearly all of Napoleon's adult life, France had been at war with England and her musical chairs group of allies. In fact, the reason for French advances in Egypt was Napoleon's refusal to agree to an invasion of England as sought by the Directory, which controlled the country. He said England's navy was too powerful, and however, taking Egypt would interfere with the British trade routes, and that would be a different matter. So that's what he did. Napoleon called Egypt the geographic key to the world. It was not lost on him that two of his heroes, Alexander the Great and Julius Caesar, both had invaded and occupied Egypt, if not conquering it completely. And both left their marks on history there. So too would Napoleon. He would accomplish his mission in a little over a year, defeating two attacks by the Turks and breaking the back of the Mamluk power that controlled the area. He defeated them at the Battle of the Pyramids. And that was in July 1798. But the longest lasting effect of the campaign was cultural. It provided intellectuals to study and write about antiquities and of the geography of the Nile River and its agricultural and spiritual importance. And they were able to gather quite a bit of information that became useful later on at home in France. Of course, most people are aware of the Rosetta Stone, the stela in three languages discovered in the Nile Delta region. Unfortunately for France, the stone was eventually given to the British when the French were forced to withdraw from Egypt in 1801. But the stone provided the key to interpret Egyptian hieroglyphics. So that became one of the great bits of information that that was drawn out of Egypt and eventually for the rest of Europe and then eventually the world was able to decipher three thousand years of history. With his popularity at a peak, Napoleon knew that if he was to fulfill his destiny that he had envisioned for himself, it was at that time. The directory was failing and was about to collapse, and chaos would have ensued. On November 9th, or in the revolutionary calendar of 18th Brumaire, 1799, Napoleon gathered forces he knew would be loyal to him. And after all, he was an accomplished and successful general. He expected that the legislature, primarily the upper chamber known as the elders, who appoint him officially as head of the army and would dissolve the revolutionary constitution. A new one would be put in place, creating a three-man consulship with Napoleon as first consul and in effect dictator. Of course, that would follow the original Roman idea when the Republic ended. Known as the Brumaire coup d'etat, the bloodless takeover, and what followed receives a lot of attention by Roberts and details all of the elements that went into Napoleon's plan. No one attempted to put up a fight to stop him from taking power. And they didn't oppose him coming up with an idea for a new constitution. Now, at the same time, he engaged in a number of military battles to force peace in Europe, which was good for him politically. However, in May 1803, Britain declared war on France again. So, by December 1804, he had maneuvered himself into a position where he declared himself the emperor. He crowned himself with the Pope as a witness, and his wife was then declared empress. became involved in a series of battles in this new war, and this included Russia and the Holy Roman Empire. But this also included the Battle of Austerlitz, one of his greatest victories. Robert's book devotes a chapter to the series of engagements by Bonaparte against Emperor Tsar Alexander I of Russia and Francis II of Austria. The tactics employed by the French leader were so successful that they have been studied by military planners ever since. Although winning a stunning victory, forcing a peace treaty of sorts, which didn't last very long, France still was at war against England and several other of her allies. Again, Bonaparte won many more battles and lost some. Perhaps the worst at the time was the historic naval engagement against the British at Trafalgar. While the hero, Admiral Lord Nelson, was killed, the British demonstrated his mastery of the sea. Roberts devotes a series of chapters on the subsequent campaigns in Spain, and once more against Russia, this time with Prussia and the United Kingdom, while France allied with Spain and several client states connected to Bonaparte's Confederation of the Rhine. All the battles are scrutinized in Robert's book, often through reports and letters written by Bonaparte himself. Through a series of political appointments, Bonaparte named his brother Joseph the King of Naples, and later the King of Spain, in hopes of quelling revolts there. He sent five armies into Portugal to tame another uprising. So the military was spread pretty thin. The book also notes that of the intrigue surrounding Napoleon's divorce of Josephine, even though he claimed still to have loved her. He had wanted an heir to his imperial throne, and she couldn't give him one. He already knew that he could sire a child through one of his mistresses, or several, so he decided he would have to divorce her. And then he had to examine the dilemma of what would happen next. He considered Tsar Alexander I a close friend. Pretty close, I would guess. This was a medallion that had a picture in it that had been struck for when the two met to form a treaty, and they were actually friends, and they were emperors, and they had mistresses in common. The two had met on a number of occasions and seemed to like each other. Napoleon considered, and one of his reasons for being friendly to the Tsar was that one possibility was to marry Alexander's sister, Grand Duchess Anna Pavlovna. However, she was only 15. He was 40. And her mother was against it. Besides the price of his sister's hand, or the price of his sister's hand, was the permanent dissolution of Poland, which had been divided among several nations. Although Napoleon was partial to Polish soldiers and cavalry and incorporated them into his army. So here was his choice. He didn't want anything to do with partitioning Poland or getting involved in that kind of a situation. So he kind of cooled on marrying Alexander's sister. But then he thought about Marie Louise, the 18-year-old daughter of the Habsburg Emperor Francis II. Now, of course, she was a little older. That was a marrying age, 18 at that time. Some in Napoleon's advisory circle didn't approve of her because she was the grandniece of Marie Antoinette. Anyway, one observer noted she's tall, well-made, in excellent health. She appeared adorned with all the grace and beauty that usually accompany youth, an air of kindness, and unlike the rest of her family, her smile was amiable and sweet. The fact that he chose to cement relations with Austria through marriage rather than Russia proved a fateful decision, one that eventually brought about his downfall. Although not evident at the time, creating an enemy of Alexander, who had the ability to join even another coalition against him, was a blunder of life-changing proportions. But it appears that he did love Marie Louise, based on hundreds of letters that survive, and in fact, she bore him a son and heir, Napoleon II, or officially Napoleon François Joseph Charles, in 1811. He was proclaimed at that point King of Rome. As reported by Roberts, Napoleon the father was quite excited by having a son and heir. Surprisingly, he wrote about his feelings in a letter to Josephine, whom he was still corresponding. My son is big and healthy. I hope that he will grow up well. He has my chest, my mouth, and my eyes. I trust he will fulfill his destiny. And that was probably kind of a dig to Josephine that I've got a son. Roberts devotes nearly the entire second half of his book on the events of 1812, meaning the invasion of Russia and a subsequent catastrophic campaign with this humiliation and his defeat. After that, Napoleon faces a downward spiral of his career, his initial abdication, his exile, his return, his second abdication, his exile, and finally his death. The reason for Napoleon's move to war against Russia had much to do with Tsar Alexander's insistence on trading with Great Britain. Although Napoleon had warned anyone trading with the British they would risk war with France, several states ignored it, and that main one being Russia. And Russia was able to form a coalition later. And this gives you an idea of the continent, a map of 1812. Marching through Allied territories after taking on minor impediments, Napoleon entered Russia even as Alexander offered peace and a chance to negotiate. In fact, Napoleon did send an emissary to the Tsar, refusing to give up any territory, but indicating it would be negotiable if Russia would give up his trade agreement with England. That was unsatisfactory to the Tsar, who appeared reluctant to accept and he was going to accept this war as inevitable. Roberts delves into the intricacies of Napoleon's alliance to create his grand army of more than 680,000 men, 300,000 of them French. To put the horror of this invasion and retreat into perspective, of the 680,000, only 120,000 survived. Only 10% of the Frenchmen survived. 30,000 out of 300,000. That would lose your points on the political spectrum. Many died in combat, but others died of disease, of starvation, or were frozen to death in the snow. The Russians, by contrast, had 200,000 troops, regular army, but conscripted 900,000. That was obviously an attack on their country, and they were willingly conscripted. Total number of deaths in the Russians were 210,000 out of over a million. As Roberts outlines, Napoleon continued to try to corner the main Russian force, but it always retreated, often burning the cities along with food supplies as it retreated. Now this, of course, can remind someone of the German invasion of Russia during World War II. The Russians did exactly the same thing by withdrawing in a scorched earth policy and drawing that enemy in, waiting for winter. And that's what the Tsar did. And by the way, from Paris to Moscow, that was the route. It was the same distance as from Bay City to Key West, Florida. So you're going to try to move 600,000 men, 250,000 horses, all the wagons, all the material, everything you need, you have to bring 1,500 miles. Not well thought out. Well, he actually thought they would surrender, that the Tsar would give up. He wouldn't surrender his forces, but he would give up and say, okay, I won't deal with England anymore. Well, didn't work that way. Now, 70 miles west of Moscow on the route, there was the Battle of Borodino. The Russians attempted to make a stand and attack the Grand Army, and then retreat and attack and retreat. But they ended up in a full-scale battle at Borodino. But not without a great loss for the French, 70,000 casualties. But it was tactically a victory because the Russians withdrew. And as we said, he had all of these things that he had to consider. He had all of these horses. He had all of the hangers-on. He had to work with he had to feed the horses. He had to feed the 600,000 people, almost 700,000. And he couldn't do it in the area surrounding it because it was burned as the Russians retreated. So we'll get the next one here. But he made it to Moscow. But as the Russians retreated from Moscow, they set it on fire. So when he got in there, all the food was gone, everything was gone. No one was there. The entire population was removed. So what did he win? He won an empty burning town. And it wasn't much of a victory. But then he realized, now what do I do? Well, he could go north to St. Petersburg, but he didn't have enough food. He had the army, but he couldn't feed them. Winter was coming. Well, winter was already there. It started out as a mild winter, but then all of a sudden it turned really bitter cold. So he decided he would have to retreat. And the weather became worse. Extreme cold and snow enveloped his army. And chaos loomed as they turned and moved westward. They were constantly, at that point, harassed by the Russians, who under General Mikhail Kutuzov managed several major victories during the French retreat. And it was a miracle that any of them returned to France. But when they did, the world had changed for Napoleon. Tsar Alexander had commented on Napoleon after the campaign. He said he had light gray eyes with a gaze at you so piercingly that you cannot withstand them. What a career he has ruined. Having gained so much glory, he could bestow peace on Europe, and he has not done so. The spell is broken. The war against Russia now allied with Austria. Now, he had married Marie Louise to have Austria as an ally. That didn't work anymore. The Emperor Francis knew, he saw the handwriting, he knew what was going on. So he joined the coalition. Smaller states, such as Bavaria, which had been a French ally, now turned. While he won a victory at Dresden on the retreat, but the intensity of the war increased. He was getting it from all sides now. And the tide turns. At Leipzig, a series of battles drove the French back and eventually out of Germany altogether. And it was only a matter of time before the coalition forces invaded France directly and would finally enter Paris. And he knew it, and they got closer, so he abdicated. He agreed to an exile as the enemy forces entered Paris. He was exiled to Elba in the Mediterranean island off Italy, which is halfway from his homeland of Corsica to Tuscany. He was also granted a guarantee of safety for his family. So that actually were generous terms when you think about it. And he was an emperor, so the other emperors thought, well, you know, could have happened to me, but it didn't. So they treated him like they would want to be treated themselves. So while on Elba, he attempted suicide by poison, but failed. And he had received word that Josephine had died in Paris on May 29th, 1814, of pneumonia. Napoleon then decided to organize a resurgence of his power, and after some planning, refitted a ship and left the island on February 26th, 1815. He landed near Cannes and headed north, swinging west to avoid royalist militia. Now, Bourbon King had been restored to the throne. You know, what became later known later for tourists as Route Napoleon, the winding course eventually reached Grenoble. And one incident along the way, which has gone down in Napoleonic lore, his march was halted when he encountered the 5th Line, which was a regiment. He reportedly threw open his coat when confronting the soldiers and pointed to his heart, asking if they would fire on their emperor. And no one did. And a wave of protest rolled through the ranks, and they said, no, we can't do that. They joined his march. And after Grenoble, he continued his march toward Paris, and his army grew. Hearing that he was coming, Louis XVIII decided was time to leave. So he fled by carriage from the Tuileries into Belgium. On the same day, Napoleon entered Paris to reestablish himself as emperor. And he set up a government. He tried to reestablish what he had before, but he realized that the enemy was still there. Another coalition had formed, and he was at war again. On May 15th, less than 2 months after he entered Paris, the new coalition rose against him, and under the English under the Duke of Wellington and the Prussians under General von Blücher, the two main Allied armies gathered in Belgium to confront the advancing force under Napoleon. However, the Emperor was outnumbered 4-1. The outcome of the battle has become, in our nomenclature, as the end of the last stand, much like in our own experience with Colonel George Armstrong Custer and his last stand at the Bighorn, Little Bighorn. The expression of Waterloo was even set to pop music by ABBA with a smash hit by that name. All is not lost, Napoleon wrote in a letter after the battle. He had plans to reassemble the remnants of his force, plus incorporating National Guard, conscripts, and units spread across the country into another fighting Grand Army. He was delusional. He was much like Hitler was with his invented armies on a map that he was moving around at the end of the war. So he was talked into abdicating once again, to surrendering to the British, and which he did. On June 24th, 1815, a new provisional government noted the abdication and put Lieutenant General Lafayette in charge of the National Guard, a position he held prior to the revolution. Lafayette saw to it that the transition of government was as bloodless as possible. One thing I noted, I don't know that I'd ever realized, well, I knew he had a name, but I never heard his name before, just the Marquis de Lafayette. Well, the name was Gilbert. There's a little trivia for you on Jeopardy. Napoleon had some friends who thought, well, maybe he could make it to the United States. He could get a ship and get through the British blockade and so forth, but that probably wasn't a good idea. Although quite a few of his followers were able to escape to the New World, primarily in Canada. So he surrendered to the British, and they put him on a ship and sent him to St. Helena Island, a British colony in the middle of the South Atlantic Ocean. It was 2,500 miles east of Brazil, 1,250 miles west of Africa, and he was at least 700 miles from any land at all. St. Helena was a volcanic island of about 50 square miles. A house was built for him, and he was allowed to have a number of servants. The new estate was called Longwood. He had made friends with the family of William Balcom, the superintendent of the East India Company on the island. He spent a great deal of time dictating his memoirs, which were published 2 years after his death, and became an international bestseller, the greatest of the 19th century, in fact. He began to have health problems in the latter part of 1816, most of which were misdiagnosed by the several doctors who were on the island. He had a tooth problem, he had jaw pain, which led to extractions, and he suffered from stomach disorders and headaches. He was believed to have had hepatitis, among other ailments. He also suffered from stomach cancer. And he endured the pain for years, and he began to suffer depression. Observers also noted that the deterioration of his appearance became prominent. He died on May 5th, 1821, and was buried with full military honors in Torbett Spring, a beautiful spot 1 mile from Longwood, punctuated with willow trees where he had sometimes visited. He was buried dressed in his colonel's uniform, which he had cherished. 19 years later, his remains were removed and taken to Paris for reburial as part of a grand funeral ceremony on the anniversary of his coronation and the Battle of Austerlitz. An estimated 1 million people lined the route of his cortege through Paris. Among those attending his interment at the Invalides were four of his marshals, but others who had turned against him and were still living refused to attend. In an aside, Roberts points out that when he heard the news of Napoleon's death, Wellington exclaimed that, "Now I may say I am the most successful general alive." It also is noted Wellington had relations with two of Napoleon's mistresses. So he was a better man, I guess, after all. He also became prime minister for 2 years, and was honored with a state funeral in 1852, thus outliving the other general by 31 years. So that is the story in this book. And I think it isn't a light read. It isn't something you would, but as a reference, it's excellent. And it also is something you could work at, you know, and reread perhaps parts, but it's also pretty interesting that we learned more about this person that we thought we knew. So, any questions on my dad?
What happened with his son?
His son, he ended up staying with his mother, but there wasn't any back in Austria.
He didn't become anyone
no.
important.
No. No. Yeah. And his nephew became Napoleon III, who reigned for a little while.
I remember reading a book about Poland, and it was here, and it was disappear, and then come back again.
Yeah.
How many times did that happen?
Well, Poland was a ping pong ball. In politics, in European politics, and so they would send an army in, stabilize it their own way, say the French way, and then Russia would come in and take over, and so they went back and forth quite a few times that way. They partitioned Poland a number of times, and it, you know, went back together, and then they partitioned. Poland?
Yeah.
Well, they had their own language. But they were always forced to speak either Russian, German, or French, depending on who was in charge. But they had their own language. But it wasn't considered a one they could actually use. It wasn't an official language in government.
How long did it take you to read that?
Well, I worked at it. Well, I took a lot of notes, and I had to go back and reread parts, and so I've had the book about 6 months, but I just went back, and I was doing a lot of other things at the time, other programs I'm doing on, and I wrote a book on local history that will be out in May, so I was busy that way. But when I was asked to do this program, that book came to mind right away. That would be one that would be good to look into if you were interested in that type of history.
We've also got Jackie Robinson.
Anybody else? I appreciate it. Pardon me? I'll be here with all the book stories.
Party all in one week.